Good day, everyone. I am Mermaid P. Duave, and today I'm gonna discuss to you the two topics, which are the learning styles and the multiple intelligences. The first topic is all about the learning styles. Now let's define what is learning style. Learning style is another factor influencing how an individual learns. Most learning style theories identify three primary modalities for learning, which are the auditory, visual, and kinesthetic. Some individuals learn best by listening, others learn best by seeing, and others learn best by doing. Although everyone can learn using each of these modalities, learning style theories suggest that each person has a preference, a dominant sensory gateway. So as we all know that each one of us is unique, like, di tayo magkakaparehas sa kung ano yung mga gusto natin o sa maging yung mga paraan natin kung paano tayo matuto. When we say learning styles, this refer to a way of a person on how he or she face or maybe absorb the task or a certain challenge. When we say learning styles, there are so many theories about it, like variety of it, but I think we should focus more on these two theories that I picked. These theories are the Kolb's learning styles and the Felder-Silverman learning styles. So let's dig in to the first theory, which is the Kolb's learning styles. Kolb's learning theory sets out four distinct learning styles, which are based on a four-stage learning cycle, which are the concrete experience, reflective observation of the new experience, abstract conceptualization, and active experimentation. Kolb explained that different people naturally prefer a certain single different learning style. As what I have said earlier, that we are all unique and we have our own preferences. Whatever influences the choice of style, the learning style preference itself is actually the product of two pairs of variables or two separate choices that we make, which Kolb presented as lines of axis, each with conflicting modes at either end. A typical presentation of Kolb's two continuums is that the east-west axis is called the processing continuum, or how we approach a task, and the north-south axis is called the perception continuum, or our emotional response, or how we think or feel about it. Now, before we dive into the chart to explain further, let us first discuss the four stages. The first stage is what we call the concrete experience. So the learner encounters a concrete experience. As the word itself, this might be a new experience or situation or a reinterpretation of existing experience in the light of new concept. This stage of learning emphasizes the personal involvement of the learner within his or her environment, or even in their daily situations. Next is the reflective observation of the new experience. The learner reflects on the new experience in the light of their existing knowledge. Of particular importance are any inconsistencies between experience and understanding. So the reflective observation, the learner or people tends to absorb or understand the ideas or situations through different point of views, like kinukonsider nila kung ano ang point of view ng isang tao if ganito ganyan ang kanyang sitwasyon. Next is the abstract conceptualization. Reflection gives rise to a new idea or modification of an existing abstract concept, or the person has learned from their experience. So in this stage, the learning involves logic, theories, and ideas rather than feelings to understand the certain situation or task. The last stage is the active experimentation. Now, the active experimentation is the newly created or modified concepts give rise to experimentation. So, the learner applies their ideas to the world around them to see what happens. This learning stage takes an active form of experimenting in different situations. Let's take a look at the chart to understand further. So, Kolb says that he has two continuums. So, what are these two continuums? So, these two continuums are all axes. We have the east-west axis and the north-to-south axis. Now, we can see in this chart the four stages, like the concrete experiences. I mean, the concrete experience, the reflective observation, the abstract conceptualization, and the active experimentation. Now, we have the east-to-west axis, or from the reflective observation to active experimentation. This is now what we call the processing continuum. Now, what does it mean when we say processing continuum? Processing continuum, or in other words, it is on how we approach a task. Now we have the second axis, which is the north to south axis, from the concrete experience to abstract conceptualization. Now that axis is called the perception continuum. This perception continuum talks about on how or our emotional response or how we think or feel about it or any kind of situation or any kind of task. Now, as we can see, the chart has like inner concepts on it. So the matrix also highlights Kolb's terminology for the four learning styles. We can see the diverging, assimilating, and converging, accommodating. Now, what are these four learning styles? Now, the first one is we have the diverging. So, these people are able to look at things from different perspectives. They are sensitive. They prefer to watch rather than do, tending to gather information and use imagination to solve problems. So they are best at viewing concrete situations from several different viewpoints. Call this style diverging because these people perform better in situations that require ideas generation. For example, brainstorming. People with a diverging learning style have broad cultural interests and like to gather information. The next one is the assimilating. So, the assimilating learning preference involves a concise, logical approach. Ideas and concepts are more important than people. These people require good, clear explanations rather than a practical opportunity. They excel at understanding wide-ranging information and organizing it in a clear, logical format. People with an assimilating learning style are less focused on people and more interested in ideas and abstract concepts. People with this style are more attractive to logical sound theories than approaches based on practical value. The third one is the converging. People with a converging learning style can solve problems and will use their learning to find solutions to practical issues. They prefer technical tasks and are less concerned with people and interpersonal aspects. So people with a converging learning style are best at finding practical uses for ideas and theories. They can solve problems and make decisions by finding solutions to questions and problems. So I can say that these people are critical thinkers and problem solvers. Now the last one is the accommodating. The accommodating learning style is hands-on and relies on intuition rather than logic. These people use other people's analysis and prefer to take a practical, experiential approach. They are attracted to new challenges and experiences and to carrying out plans. They commonly act on gut. So, according to both Kolb, learning stages in the cycle could be used by teachers to critically evaluate the learning provision typically available to students and to develop more appropriate learning opportunities. So through this theory, we can assess and see if what we should do if the person or the learner prefer this kind of learning style than this. Like, we can provide a specific, like, for example, an activity for that learner to give them more opportunities to shine or to enhance their potential. Because each one of us has different, like, different preferences in learning, as I have said earlier. So we should take this opportunity to strengthen and to apply this experiential learning cycle. Now let's move on to the second theory, which is the Felder-Silverman learning styles. So the Felder-Silverman model denotes four areas or domains of personality that contribute to learning. The model creates four dimensions of learning styles. These dimensions can be viewed as a continuum with one learning preferences on the far left and the other on the far right. So the first domain is the active reflective. So this domain determines how you prefer to process information. So this is how when a person wants to adopt or receive information. Next is we have the visual verbal. This domain determines how you prefer information to be presented. Like, if you want the information to be presented to you, like, verbally or like through chat lang, like ganyan good. Third one is the sensing intuitive. This domain determines how you prefer to perceive or take in information. So the last one is the sequential global domain. So this determines how you prefer to organize and progress toward understanding information. We can refer to this chart to understand further. Now let's move on to the next topic, which is the multiple intelligences. So it is important for teachers to be aware of the multiple types of student intelligences when planning lessons. The concept of multiple intelligences was developed by Howard Gardner, who introduced a revolutionary theory of various kinds of intelligences. A learner may exhibit more than one kind of genius. This study or theory successfully frees the limiting confines of IQ, theory measured by Alfred Binet. Now let's discuss each of these intelligences. So the first one is the linguistic intelligence. So this refers to the ability to understand and use spoken and written language. Individuals who possess strong linguistic intelligence, such as writers, poets, speakers, and lawyers, can express themselves well in both written and verbal communications. So this linguistic intelligence, these are the people where they find the right words or use the right words to express themselves. Kumbaga, nakukuha or nagagamit or nakakapagsalita talaga sila kung ano yung gusto nilang sabihin. Like, they find the exact or the right word to share their ideas. Next is the logical mathematical intelligence. It is the ability of students in terms of numbers and logic, which involves the skills to process words and numbers, to use logic and analyze problems logically, to find formulas, and to do investigations scientifically. So I admit that I am not this kind of smart. Like, I hate math. Like, I am not good at numbers. So, for me, those, like, math wizards are so blessed. Because they can understand math easily, like, napaprocess agad nila kahit, like, for example, while nagde-discuss kayo, like, isang example lang yung binigay, tapos gets na nila agad. Like, diba, sana all. Next, we have the musical intelligence, also called musical rhythmic intelligence. So, it is the ability to comprehend and produce musical skills such as rhythm, lyrics, and patterns. People who demonstrate musical intelligence often think in music and rhymes and learn concepts easier when turned into a song. The next one is the visual spatial intelligence. It is the ability to perceive, analyze, understand, store, and recall visual information. It allows you to visualize, create, and manipulate yourself and other items in space. So, in other terms, visualizing the world in 3D. Next, we have the bodily kinesthetic intelligence. It is the ability or the capacity to manipulate objects and use a variety of physical skills. This intelligence also involves a sense of timing and the perfection of skills through mind-body union. People belong in this kind of intelligence are those like dancers, athletes, kasi this intelligence requires coordination of your mind and body. Next is the interpersonal intelligence. Interpersonal intelligence is the ability to understand and interact effectively with others. It involves effective verbal and nonverbal communication, the ability to note distinction among others, sensitivity to the moods and temperaments of others, and the ability to entertain multiple perspectives. So these peoples are tend to observant, like nasasabi nila if may change ng mood yung nakakausap nila or nafe-feel nila kung ano yung like aura sa kanilang paligid, ganun. Next, we have the intrapersonal intelligence. So, it is the ability to understand oneself, including their thoughts, fears, and motivations, and the ability to then utilize this understanding to make decisions and communicate. So, this intrapersonal person is understanding yourself, like what you feel, what you want, and what you need. So, they tend to know themselves better than anyone. So, according to Gardner, the naturalist intelligence is the ability to identify, classify, and manipulate elements of the environment, like the objects, animals, or plants. So, the naturalist intelligence refers to understanding living things and reading nature. You can refer to this chart. And that's all. Thank you for listening.